they bow before your throne. All the elders cast their crowns before the Lamb of God and sing, "You're worthy of it all.
Tetelestai, paid in full. That was the title of last Sunday's message. Hello and welcome to another beautiful Sunday service at the Lighthouse Digital Church. My name is Tama. I'll be taking us through the recap of last Sunday's sermon. So, Tetelestai, that one was so fascinating to me that I had to get front row seats to the sermon. Obviously, I was the first person in church because I just wanted to know what it was all about, and I was not disappointed. When Pastor David started to take us through what Jesus Christ did for us at the cross of Calvary, and he summarized it in this very beautiful word that I've always loved, sozo. What Jesus did, sozo means salvation, but it is so much more. It is all encompassing, if I can say that. It means you've been saved, it means you've been delivered, it means you've been rescued, it means you've been protected, you are protected. It means that all of God's glorious riches, all of his inheritance in us, for us, are captured in that word, sozo. You know, frankly for me, you don't have to tell me twice. The first time I heard it, I believed it. And when I heard it again, I believed it again. So I hope that you believe that Jesus Christ did everything for you. I hope you believe that you've been saved. I hope you believe that you have been delivered and God is constantly delivering you. I hope that you believe that you are a protected child. I hope that you believe that you have a healer, because healing is still a part of the sozo package. Let us head over to the main service and enjoy another beautiful message from Pastor Davis. Thank you.
Praise God forevermore. Wonderful Father, we thank you for the gift of life. We thank you for what you are going to do this morning. We thank you for the revelation knowledge that will come through my lips to the ears of your people, empowered by the Holy Ghost, saturated with the Spirit of the Most High God, enwrapped in the blood of Jesus, and with the approval of God the Father, that people will realize the totality and the perfection of what Christ has done for us. Lord, help our hearts this morning to leap out with joy upon realizing the finality of what Christ has achieved for us. Thank you, Almighty God. May someone leave here this morning, O God, with an understanding of what you have done for us, Jesus, and walk in the consciousness of what that means, in the name of Jesus. Thank you, wonderful Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Hallelujah. Praise God forevermore. Now today I'm going to continue part 3 of the message that I started 2 weeks ago. We've done part 1, part 2. Please, if this is your first time of coming to church, I highly recommend that you go back to the YouTube channel and go and watch part 1 and part 2 of this message to give you the full context. This message, by the grace of God, I will endeavor to finish next week, which is the resurrection morning. Praise God. And after next week, I'm going to be starting a new series that is going to be talking about the 3 days that changed the world. I'm going to talk about what happened between when Christ died and when he was raised from the dead. It's going to change your life. So please look forward to that. All right, so today we're going to pass part 3 of the message that says Tetelestai, paid in full. Now, if you remember, I think about 4 weeks ago, I spoke about the law of the Goel. And in the law of the Goel, I mentioned that the Goel must possess 3 qualities in order for the Goel to qualify to be able to redeem somebody. And the word Goel means my kinsman redeemer, which means if somebody was sold into slavery, because the person couldn't pay someone, you're owing somebody money, couldn't pay. It is only somebody from your household, somebody who is related to you, a kinsman, that can redeem you back, that can buy you back. And the word redeem actually means to buy back from the slave market. Now, and I said, the person who is the goel must have three qualities. Must be a kinsman. Number two, must have the means to redeem. And number three, must be willing to redeem. And I've covered it with you already that Christ possessed those three qualities. That was the reason why he was able to redeem us. He has bought us back from the slave market of sin, sickness, debauchery, or anything that the enemy wants to put against us. All that is left for us now is to believe that we have been redeemed so that we don't go back to it. Now, there was one statement I made which I want to re-emphasize again, that the redemption must be so total that a person who has been thus redeemed must not have any consciousness that the redemption has not happened. Essentially, what it means is this: when Christ redeemed us, we must agree that our redemption happened. We must no longer have a consciousness like, oh, maybe I'm no longer saved, or maybe something is still left in my account that God is holding against me. We may have had messages preached to us. We may have had preachings that we've heard that says, actually, after you give your life to Jesus, if you sin, God charges the sin back against you. I'm going to show you something today that will help you to understand the error in that thought process. Open your heart. Please don't close it as I step into this message. Today I'm going to be talking about tetelestai, paid in full, completely complete, perfectly perfect. What do I mean by that? Tetelestai, completely complete, perfectly perfect. There was a man that I read his book one time. I think the man is Derek Prince. He said the day that he had an impression, a serious impression about the meaning of the cross, was one time when he was somewhere and he was trying to minister to somebody, and the Holy Spirit showed him, you know, a revelation about the cross of Jesus, and the words he heard were the words perfectly perfect, completely complete, which means the sacrifice of Jesus at Calvary's Hill was so perfect that you cannot add or remove anything from it. So why did the Holy Spirit choose the word tetelestai? As I've mentioned before, tetelestai is from the Greek language. Now, this word tetelestai was translated to mean "it is finished" in the English translation. Now, the challenge with the English translation is that the English translation is not rich enough. The English language is not rich enough to translate the depth and the meaning of some of the words in the Bible. So, which means if you are an avid student of the Bible, it behoves you a responsibility to study the Bible and understand the meaning of words. There's something in languages called etymology of words, which means the root meaning of words. So if, for example, the word Jesus has its root in Yahweh or Jehovah saves, Jesus, the root of that is Jehovah saves, which means Jehovah saves or Jehovah restores, Jehovah delivers. So essentially it's talking about the name of Jesus Christ is rooted in the fact that it is linked to the name Jehovah or the name Yahweh. Yahweh saves, Yahweh delivers. Do you understand that? That's the etymology. That's the root meaning of that word. All right. Okay. So which means when you hear words, words have roots, have meaning. It springs from something. It might come from Latin. It might be original. It might come from Latin, but it means something. It might come from Greek. It means something. Why am I emphasizing this? Because what I want to share with you today will lay to rest this security that believers have in Christ Jesus, or the perfection, the completion of the finished work of Jesus Christ. Because once you understand this finished work of Jesus Christ, it will make your walk with the Lord totally a game changer. Now, the Old Testament of the Bible was written in Hebrew language. The New Testament of the Bible was written in the Greek language originally. Okay, now, the language that Jesus Christ spoke when he was on the earth was from the Aramaic language. So at times when I do my study, I try to understand the Aramaic language that Jesus Christ spoke. At times I try to understand what is the Greek meaning of this? What was the writer trying to convey by the word spoken, so that I can understand the context? Okay. Now, if the Holy Spirit, when the New Testament was being written in Greek, laid in the heart of the writer to use the word tetelestai to describe what Jesus Christ spoke on the cross when he said it is finished, it behoves us a responsibility to understand why did the Holy Spirit choose that particular word and why was it chosen. Does that make sense? Okay, John chapter 19 verse 30, the Bible says when Jesus Christ had received the sour wine, he said it is finished, and he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. This word, it is finished, in the Greek is the word tetelestai. But tetelestai is made up of two tenses in the Greek language. It's made up of the perfect tense and what they call the aorist tense. The aorist tense is a tense that depicted that something happened a moment in history, at a moment in time. For example, if you graduated university in 1960, that happened in 1960, is a moment in history, something that is undeniable. So in the English language, you have the words, if somebody says it is finished, means it is done, it's complete, right? And if we say it is finishing, it means it is present continuous. But you see, when the Bible was translated in English, they used the word it is finished, which means it is complete, is that's where it's ended, right? Okay, now when the Greek language used that same word, it is using the aorist tense to say this happened a point in time. All right, like Jesus Christ died, you know, let's say AD 32. That's a point in time in history. You cannot contest that. It's something that is written in the annals of history that he came and he died on that particular day. Does that make sense? Okay, so on the day that he died, it is finished. Our sins paid for, it is finished. Now, but the problem is if we look at that tense only in that context, the problem that would then arise in people's minds will be, okay, he died 2,000 years ago. All of my sins up until that point in time were paid for. But what about the ones that I've committed, errors that I've gone into after that time? Then what happens? Does that mean that the sacrifice of Jesus Christ was no longer sufficient for that? And that is the reason why in the Greek language, the Holy Spirit allowed the writer to use the word tetelestai, which has both the perfect tense and the aorist tense. You can call it pre-perfect tense, which essentially means something that happened at a point in time, aorist tense, and something that is presently ongoing that has eternal ramification. Essentially, it's talking about a perfect tense and aorist tense. Essentially, what the Bible is trying to communicate to you, or the Holy Spirit is trying to communicate to you, is that the death of Jesus, when he said it is finished on the cross, represented two things. Something that happened at that moment in time that you cannot gainsay. Something that also has continuous ramification, continuous impact, continuous meaning, continuous finality, for all eternity. Does that make sense? So when we say completely complete, it means it was complete when it happened. It is complete now. It will complete in the future. Does that make sense? It is already complete. So you can't add to it, you can't remove from it. Another angle to look at this tense from is, none of you listening to me right now was alive when Jesus died. So the death of Jesus and what it represents happened at that moment in time over 2,000 years ago. So we, in the present time, we look back to what Jesus Christ did 2,000 years ago. We look back to it. And that's how we became saved. Those who are in the old covenant, they look forward to that day. And that's how they became saved. They became saved too by faith. Abraham got saved by faith. David got saved by faith. None of these people, David, Abraham, Moses, none of them was perfect. There was no one among them that could be declared perfect in terms of holiness. God saved them by faith because they were looking forward to Jesus when he was going to come. We look backward to Jesus when we got saved. But if we stop there and tetelestai was not pronounced as a present, ongoing, continuous effect in our lives, we would be riddled with condemnation. And at times when you go to churches, they preach a message that says, even though you were saved once, when you mess up in the present, God literally put the sin back in your charge. And I'm going to tell you today, as I go through different examples, that that is a lie. That is not correct. Should we ask for forgiveness when we go in error, when we sin? 100%. But I'll tell you the reason why we should do that at the end, towards the end of this broadcast. Let's step into the message. So you know the meaning of tetelestai based on the Greek tenses that were used to describe that particular word, because it is very important for you to understand it. If you don't understand it, you're going to get it confused. So tetelestai means it is finished in English. I see something that just happened and that's it. But in the Greek, the tenses used suggested aorist tense. It happened a moment in history, just like the English mentioned, but it also has continuous present ramification. Praise God. So tetelestai, translated paid in full, is a word that suggested that it is finished, it stands finished, it will always be finished. Praise God forevermore. So it describes a past completed act with present effect, and this emphasizes that the completed event of Jesus Christ's death has eternal ramification, or has a permanent effect. So once I got saved by that, the blood of Jesus Christ that was shed for me, I remain saved by that same blood. When I mess up, what should I do? Just wait for it. I'm going to get there in a moment. Praise God. Now that you understand this tetelestai, the tenses, what it means, I'm going to go through about 5 examples that will help to bring these to life. Example number 1. Suppose you have a servant and you give a servant an assignment and say, hey, John, I want you to go to the farm and cut this pathway and plant this crop. These are your to-do list. If John goes to the farm and does as you have instructed him to do, and he comes back, he will say, I have tetelestai'd it. I have done the things which you have asked me to do. I have completed it. Jesus Christ himself said in the book of John, let's look at the book of John. Book of John, chapter 6, he said, My food is to do the will of the Father who sent me. But when you go to John chapter 17 verse 4, he said, I have tetelestai'd the work which you have given to me to do. All right. So those words essentially means I have done it. There's nothing left for me to do. Another example is has to do with the priest. In the olden days, during the time when the old covenant was still in effect, if you were to bring a lamb for sacrifice, that lamb has to be perfect. If you bring a lamb that has blemishes, a lamb that is not perfect, maybe one of the eyes has been gouged out, it's not acceptable. It's not perfect. All right, God will not accept it. Okay, if you bring a lamb to appease for your sin, what you have done under the old covenant, the lamb has to be perfect. And the lamb will be checked by the priest to see that, you know, everything is okay. There are no blemishes. There are no flaws in the lamb. And when the priest finds out there are no flaws or blemishes in the lamb, the priest will say, tetelestai. It is finished. It's complete. There are no flaws in it. Now, the Bible says of Jesus, 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 18 to 19, the Bible says, for you know that your lives were ransomed paid, redeemed, bought back from the slave market. Your lives were ransomed once and for all. Once and for all. Ponder that statement. Your life was ransomed once and for all. Do you understand again what I'm saying here? Your life was ransomed once and for all. You were bought back from the slave market once and for all. Christ did not have to go and buy you back again. Your life was ransomed, redeemed from the slave market once and for all. How? By the blood of Jesus. The Bible here says, once and for all, from the empty and futile way of life handed down from generation to generation. It was not a ransom payment of silver and gold, which eventually perishes, but by the precious blood of Jesus Christ, who like a spotless, unblemished lamb was sacrificed for us. Jesus Christ was the unspotted, unblemished lamb that was sacrificed for us. He was sacrificed on our behalf. The same way the priest would look at the lamb and say, "Tetelestai," Christ was a spotless, unblemished lamb that was sacrificed for us. It was a lamb that was tetelestai, that is spotless, and it was sacrificed for us. Praise God. Another point: if you are an artist under the olden day, during the era of our forefathers in the faith, and you decide to draw a picture, you draw a picture. Perfect picture, you've done it, it has conveyed the image you had in your heart, and you've painted it, you said, this is so good, there's nothing more to add to this picture. You will write on it, "Tetelestai." When the Lord made the heavens and the earth, every single time God did something and he looked at it, he would say, "It is good." That word "it is good" means I don't have to add anything to it again. It's an old covenant way of saying "Tetelestai." It is finished. It is completely complete. It is perfectly perfect. Nothing more to add to it. I hope that makes sense. Okay, let's look at another one. Merchant. This one actually makes a lot of sense to me, and I will explain to you why in a moment. You see, if you are owing a merchant money, let's say you go and buy something from a shop, they give you credit line, $10,000, $20,000. You have that credit against your name, which means you are owing them $10,000, right? Look, they gave you a credit line, $20,000. You're owing them. So every time your statement comes through the post, you will see that you are owing $10,000, $20,000, as the case may be. That's the amount you are owing. So you owe the merchant $20,000. Suppose you therefore decide to pay off what you owe the merchant. Once you have paid that money that you owe the merchant, you can write on the your account, maybe you have a paper account, you can say, "Tetelestai, paid in full. There's nothing left to be paid." I told you my story, how God made me to be debt free. I was under the debilitating weight of debt. I was owing maybe $50,000 or £50,000 or something. I can't remember how much I was owing. And God told me, "My son, it is not my will for you to be in debt." God said to me, "The reason why you are not paying this debt is because you thought all the money is going to come from you." God said, "Believe me for it." And God gave me an instruction. He said, "Bring out the checks and write down the full amount that you owe these people to the penny. Write it down and say, 'Pay so, so and so to the order of this amount,' and sign it and date it and pray over it." And that's what I did. I wrote 3 checks, prayed over them, wrote the full amount and put in my Bible. Forgot about it. Anytime a thought comes to me, "Oh, is something going to happen?" I just kept saying, "God, I said I should do this. I believe him for it." Obviously, God told me, "I'm a fair God. The people that you're owing, you have to arrange some sort of monthly payment." And God said to me, "The reason why you are not making an arrangement to give them monthly payment is because you look at how much you're earning at the moment. You thought, oh man, I can't afford that. You know, because I cannot flow the money to you unless you put something in place. So I put something in place. I think I'll spend them £100 every single month, you know, and I then did what God told me about writing the checks. And people of God, within 3 to 4 months, every single money was paid off through God's supernatural means, through the inflow, open doors. So now here's a question. If any of those people that I owed suddenly come back and say, oh man, you're still owing us, will I not bring out the evidence, the checks that I paid, that cleared in the account, and say, look, I've written on this check, paid in full, I'm not owing you anymore, and therefore you cannot charge me to court that I'm still owing you the money that I've paid you. The other day, actually, I was talking about this to my friend Patrick, and he said something that really, really blessed me, which I want to share with you. He said, actually, the payment that God made on behalf of us to buy us back from the slave market of sin, the slave market of sickness or debauchery or a lifestyle of evil, was an overpayment. There's nothing in all of the universes combined together that is worth the value of Jesus Christ. But God, in His mercy, equated the value of redeeming the world to be equal to the value of His Son. I want you to think about that carefully. Jesus left heaven to come and pay the price for you and I. And when God says, okay, who is qualified, of whose value can I attribute that will equate to the value of the people that I want to redeem? God said, the life of my Son. So you are worth the value of the life of Jesus. You might not have a penny to your account. You might not have a name against you in the world. You might not be a celebrity. Nobody might know you. But if you have given your life to Jesus, I want you to know that you are of an extreme worth to God. You are of an extreme worth to God. The worth of your life is the life of Jesus. The worth of your life is the life of Jesus. When God was weighing it out, He says, what is the worth that this child of mine should have? It's the life of Jesus. Now, do you see how understanding this truth will allow you to never ever give in to low self-esteem or somebody thinking, oh, you don't measure up? The King of the universe, the God who spawned the stars into space, looked through everything He has done and said, what do I need to do to bring Davis home? Or John home, or Johanna, or whatever your name is. And He said, the value is the life of my Son. The Bible says, if God did not spare Jesus, but gave Him up for us, how will He not with Him freely give us all things? Do you know what that means? It means, if God did not spare Jesus, and said, you know, Jesus Christ, you got to pay this price, got to die for these people. And Jesus Christ said, Daddy, I'm going to do it. It is written in the book that I will do it. And I'm doing this of a free will. The Bible said, if God did not spare Jesus, He put all our sin upon Him, He died in our place, how much more will God not with Jesus give us free things, all things freely? Which means we are not even here meant to be begging God and begging God and begging God. God wants to bless us more than we want the blessing. So God wants you to know that the debt that you owe has been paid. It's been paid in full. It's an overpayment. Praise God forevermore. You know, if you also consider another way, suppose you own a mortgage. You own a mortgage. Let's say your house you want to buy is £250,000, and you pay £50,000 as a deposit. That is your own money. You're owing the bank £200,000. Do you know that the bank now holds the title deed to that your property until you pay off the amount you're owing them, right? If you come into some money and you pay the £200,000 that you're owing the bank, the bank is going to release what? The title deed, the full ownership of the house to you. The bank can no longer then come back and say you are still owing money because you've paid in full. That is why Charles Spurgeon, I think it was Charles Spurgeon that says, there's no mortgage on the saints, which means you are not paying installment. You're not saying, oh, I'm saved, but I have to pay installment in prayer. I have to pay installment in confession. I have to pay installment in doing penance. I have to do this, I have to do that because I've got a mortgage to pay for my salvation. There's no such thing as that. Christ either paid it in full or we are still condemned. But praise God, he paid it in full 100%. We have been redeemed by the blood of Jesus. We have been bought back from the slave market. It's paid in full. The certificate of debt has been paid in full. Whatever I'm owing somebody, those people I owe them, they can't come back and say, oh, Davis, you're owing them. No, paid in full. If I pay off the mortgage tomorrow, the bank cannot come back and say, oh, you're still owing money on that mortgage. Paid in full. I hope you understand that. Praise God. All right, let's go to the last point I want to make. You know, when the Bible says, there's therefore now no condemnation for them who are in Christ Jesus, that statement is coming from this premise that whatever it is that will condemn us has been taken out of the way. Christ has paid the price fully. Therefore, we stand uncondemned before the Almighty God. When Grudem adds this text, if Christ had not paid the full penalty, there would still be condemnation left for us. But since he paid the full penalty that is due to us, there is therefore now no condemnation to them who are in Christ Jesus. The question is whether you are going to believe it. Now, the last point I want to make here is tetelestai as it pertains to a prisoner. Now, suppose somebody, you know, committed a crime and the person is put in jail. If the person has paid the price, has gone to jail and come out of jail, do you suppose the person can ever be sent to jail again for the same offense? I don't think so. Let me show you something about the law. There's a law called the law of double jeopardy. The law of double jeopardy. Actually, I pulled this one from hse.gov.uk. Listen to what it says. It says, a person may not be tried for a crime for which he or she has previously been acquitted or convicted, or in respect of which he or she, on the same previous indictment or summons, have been lawfully convicted, where the offense charged in the second indictment summons was committed at the time of the first charge. Let me try and break it down because it's, you know, this is legal speech. What it's saying here is that you cannot be brought to the court of law again for a crime which you have previously been either been set free from, or you have been convicted and you have paid the price for it. They cannot bring you back to court and say, oh, we're charging you for murder again. If, for example, you killed somebody, God forbid, and you were sent to prison and say, oh, because it's murder, it's not going to be, they're not going to kill you, but you know what? You're going to pay, you're going to stay in jail for 20 years. And after 20 years, you have actually served your time and you now come out of jail. They cannot come back and say, oh, by the way, as you are going, I say, come here. We need to throw you in jail again. It's not possible. That is called the law of double jeopardy. A person cannot be tried again for an offense in which the person has already paid for it and has not been asked to go free because the payment for that offense has been paid for. It is called the law of double jeopardy. Now, in the olden days, there's a scripture that I found in the NASB version of Colossians chapter 2, verses 14 to 15. I'm going to read it and I'm going to explain the context so that you can understand it. Now, this text, I will deep dive on it next week. Next week, I'm going to be preaching about Tetelestai part 4, three things that happened at the cross. Please come next week. You're going to love it. You're going to receive the truth that will set you free. Three things happened at the cross. I'm going to be using Colossians chapter 2, verses 12 to 15 or 16 to preach, to talk about these things. But today, I'm just giving you a preview of this thing as it relates to tetelestai. Colossians 2, 14 to 15 in the NASB says, having cancelled out the certificate of debt consisting of decrees against us, which was hostile to us, and he has taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross. So the certificate of debt, I highlighted it, certificate of debt is what we owe. The Bible says this certificate of debt consists of what? Decrees that were against us. Thou shalt not. If you do this, this is going to happen. All those decrees that were against us, they were actually hostile to us. They were contrary to us, right? It took them out of the way. But those things that were contrary to us, they were written on that certificate of debt. Oh, David, you owe this. David, you owe a penalty of death for lying. You owe a penalty of, lifetime imprisonment for nasty thought in your mind. You know, Davis, you owe a debt of 15 year in bondage because, you know, you didn't pay tithe or something. You know what I mean? Or that you, there was stuff like that. Those decrees were against us. But the Bible here says those decrees were against us were on this certificate of debt that we owe. We owe a debt. We couldn't pay it. Right? Bible says those things were against us. He took them out of the way. How? He nailed it to the cross. He nailed it, that certificate of debt that has all the sins we're owing. He nailed it to the cross where he was hung himself. Now, then he then did something. He disarmed the rulers and authorities. That's the devil. He made a public display of them and triumph over them through him. I'm not going to talk about that one today, but I just want you to focus on the certificate of debt. Now, as I do my study, one thing I came across was about how during the Roman time, the Roman were the world power when Jesus Christ came into the world, all right? Because his indictment, as it were, was signed by, you know, Pontius Pilate, right? Pontius Pilate was a Roman soldier, all right? So the Romans were the ones who were in world power, where the world power during the time that Jesus Christ came to the world. All right, but there was this research I found that says that when a Roman citizen was convicted of a crime, he was thrown into a prison. A certificate of debt listing all his crimes was nailed to his cell door so that anyone passing by could know what he had been accused of and the penalty assessed. So I don't know whether you're seeing it on the screen, I'm just reading it, okay? Now, when the prisoner had served his sentence and was released from bondage, the indictment was taken down from the door, and the judge who had put him in prison would sign the indictment and write across it the word tetelestai. The freed prisoner was then given this document, and if questioned as to why he was out of jail, he could point to the indictment across which the judge had written tetelestai. He could rest in safety and security because the word tetelestai guaranteed his deliverance and his liberty. The charges for those crimes could never again be brought against him. This is so beautiful. There are things in these sentences I've read that if you can see it, it will help you. One of the things I want to call out here is that when you are freed from prison, there was a document that was given to you written by the blood of Jesus, says tetelestai, it is finished, all charges paid for, all charges, you know, paid, nothing more for you to do. Now suppose somebody accosts you on the way and say, oh, by the way, you're still a sinner, you need to be able to say, by the blood of Jesus, I remain a saint forever. Now but suppose you don't know that you're saved and the blood of Jesus Christ continues to save you, what's going to happen? You start to relate to God like a sinner. You start to say to yourself, oh, I'm a sinner. God does not hear the prayers of sinners, so God will not hear my prayer. Do you see how damaging it is when we believe the wrong concept about what Christ has done? If you understand the finished work of Jesus Christ at Calvary's Hill, it will totally change your life. Tetelestai. The other thing I want to point out here is that You are meant to rest in safety and security because the word tetelestai guarantees your deliverance and your liberty. If somebody were to say, why are you resting in the Lord Jesus? You ought to say, because I have tetelestai. My sins have been paid for. I have been redeemed finally by the blood of Jesus Christ. I cannot be put back under bondage again. Now, do you see now how ridiculous it is? Therefore, when we try through merchandising or through ignorance to put believers back under condemnation. You know, condemnation is a result of breaking the law. A person who broke the law is condemned to die or is condemned to get some judgment for the law that the person has broken. But when the Bible says in Romans 8:1 that there is therefore now no condemnation to them who are in Christ Jesus, it is therefore wrong for us to preach a message that brings believers back under condemnation. It's almost like we're saying Christ never died. Christ did not pay for it. Christ did not sit at tetelestai at the cross. Therefore, a person who now lives under condemnation or guilt has not appropriated what Jesus Christ has done for him or her. Now, if you are not living under condemnation and nothing is working in your life, how could we turn around then and blame God and say, oh, it's because it's God that has caused it? And then we turn God to Baal, you know, where we say, oh, God, help me. Oh, God, help me. And we're cutting ourselves figuratively. We wanted blood to come out to appease God. God is not Baal that we have to appease with our blood, that we have to shed tears, that we have to cry, we have to do some religious demonstration before God can move in our lives. You know, the other day God was telling me something. God was saying to me, how many times have you seen Jesus pray and he acted like a demon possessed person? At times we pray, we have to bang our head, oh Lord, gymnastics, all religious appetunances that are not relevant. I was telling this to my friend Patrick the other day. I said, look, I said, God was telling me, what is all this gymnastic that we're doing? What is all that? You have never seen Jesus Christ come to a place of prayer and he just was banging his head and he has to run around like crazy person before prayers get answered? No, even when he faced the most challenging situation in part of his ministry, when he had 5 loaves and 2 fish, he didn't run around and like acting like crazy person before the 5 loaves got multiplied and fed 5,000 people. Even when he was in the boat and there was windstorm and the wind was blowing and he was sleeping. When he saw the wind, what did he say? He said, peace, be still. He didn't run around acting crazy. He didn't say, bring anointing oil or bring prayer shawl before prayer gets answered. Do you see what I'm saying here? There are people out there that are trying to merchandise you to get something out of you because you have not understood and accepted that tetelestai is not something that happened once. It's something that happened at that point in history, but I still continue to have relevance in your life every single day. The word tetelestai means it is finished, it remains finished, it will forever be finished. What you need to live this life, people of God, don't let anybody take you in bondage. You have been set free from the prison. Don't get yourself entangled again in the yoke of bondage. Galatians chapter 5 verse 1 says, for freedom as Christ set us free, let us again not get entangled again in the yoke of bondage. What is this yoke of bondage is talking about? Do you think it's just talking about sin? No, it's talking about law-mindedness. It's talking about performance Christianity. It's talking about, oh, I need to do this before God can move in my life. People of God, it is finished. Christ did it. You don't have a farthing to pay. The blood of Jesus Christ still speaks for you. Praise God forevermore. So I've spoken to you about the law of double jeopardy. You cannot be a victim of double jeopardy. You cannot pay for the same crime twice. When Jesus Christ cried tetelestai on the cross, he was saying that anyone who places his trust in his sacrificial debt on their behalf receives in essence a certificate of debt with the inscription tetelestai, indicating that all their crimes, past, present, and future, against God, have been paid for in full. Hallelujah! If that does not rock your boat, I don't know what will. Listen to me. In light of this truth, Apostle Paul wrote something in Colossians chapter 2, verse 13. Again, I'm going to cover this next week in detail. I want you to read to you in the ESV version. It says, and you who were dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made alive together with him, having forgiven us all our trespasses. I want you to notice the word all there. The word all means all. It means that which is the totality of it. Now, if he forgave your sins, all of your sins, before you ever committed them, why will you put yourself under the bondage of sin consciousness, constantly carrying this sin everywhere that you go? He paid the sin for the sin before you committed them. When you therefore gave your life to Jesus, God credited into your account that payment. And that payment that was credited into your account is effective. Why? Because tetelestai means something that happened in the past, but that has continuous present and eternal ramification. Praise God. Christ has utterly wiped out. In the Greek, that word forgiven us all, forgiven means completely obliterated the condemning evidence of the broken laws and commandments which always hung over our heads, and has completely annulled it by nailing it over his own head on the cross. And then, having drawn the sting of all the power raged against us, he exposed them, shattered them, emptied them, defeated them, and in his final glorious triumphant act. Praise God forevermore. People of God, Satan may accuse you, put condemnation and thought into your mind. What do you need to do? You need to bring out that certificate of death and say, listen, tetelestai, the blood of Jesus Christ has spoken for me. When the enemy comes to bring accusation into your life, let me show you something. In the book of Zechariah chapter 3, I can't really go into detail here. The Bible talks about Joshua. He was being accused by the devil. You did this, you did that, you did that, you did that, you did that. And Jesus Christ said, the Lord who chose this one out of fire rebuke you, Satan. When the enemy comes against you with accusation, the advocate, Jesus Christ, will say, I object. My blood speaks for this one. And the judge of the whole universe, your father, will say, objection sustained. I'll say that again. When the enemy accuses you of high treason against God, today you have an advocate. You have an advocate. The Bible says, we have an advocate with the Father. First John chapter 2 verse 1. If any one of you sin, actually it says, I write this to you so that you do not sin. But if any one of you sin, you have an advocate before the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. So when the enemy accuses you of treason against God, I want you to remember, there's one beside the Father who is a righteous one, who is your advocate, your paracletos. And he will say, I object to that one because my blood paid for it. Tetelestai, forever paid for, completely complete, perfectly perfect. And the Father has to say, objection sustained. Praise God. There is therefore now no condemnation to them who are in Christ Jesus. So when I go into error, my sins have been paid for. I'm forgiven past, present, and future. When I go into error, what shall I do? What shall I do? Because we go into error from time to time. Yeah? If God were looking at sin or judging sin, the way people are talking about it, nobody will stand. Let me rehash that for you. You may not commit adultery. Have you had a nasty thought from time to time? Sin is not what people do. Sin is both internal and external. If God were looking at that, you cannot stand. But let's suppose, let's go down the pathway. You got yourself into error. What should you do? You should ask for forgiveness. Why are you asking for forgiveness? Because that question is not ringing in your mind. If my sins have been paid for, why am I asking for forgiveness? You are asking for forgiveness because of your heart. It's not because the Father is holding the sin against you. You are asking for that forgiveness because of your heart. You are asking for that forgiveness so that you can have this relationship with the Father. You can have koinonia. You can have intimacy with the Father. Remember when Adam sinned in the garden? God knew he sinned in the garden, but God was the one that was still coming and say, Adam, where are you? He was coming to have fellowship time with Adam. But Adam now, conscious of his sin, the nature of sin that he now has, he was now hiding from the Father. Sin will make you hide from the Father. The Father never hides from you. Hebrews chapter 13 verse 5 says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. That's what God said. God said, I will never, ever, ever leave you nor forsake you. And that word never is the word who me, O-U-I for me. It means never, ever, ever. It's like double negative. God said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. So even when you sin, God never leaves you. God is still coming to you and say, child of God, you are better than this. You are royalty. But you run away from him because now you are carrying this consciousness of sin. But the Bible says we should come boldly to the throne of grace to receive grace that we need in time of need. What does the time of need mean? Time of need means when you are vulnerable, when you find yourself falling into sin, right? Doing things that you ought not to do as royalty. Don't run away from God. Run to God. Say, Daddy, I messed up there. I'm sorry. I'm royalty. How could I have done that? Forgive me. I plead that blood that was shed for me 2,000 years ago, that I know is still available now. I hide myself under it. Father, and I thank you that you have already forgiven me this sin, even before it was committed. Father, I stand now upon the righteousness that I continue to possess in Christ Jesus. Now, you see, as you come in there, with that kind of mindset, you come boldly to the throne room of grace so you can receive that grace from God. You realize that because you have brought that into limelight, you have exposed that sin, you have opened your own mouth to say it, that is stops having power over you. Immediately you do that before God, the Satan will not have any accusation to come against you. Do you understand what I'm saying? Now, the Father never left. The Father will never leave. But why do you ask for forgiveness? So your own heart can stay pure before God. Do you understand what I'm saying? So yeah, your own heart will not condemn you. In fact, the Bible even says that if your heart condemns you, God is greater than your heart. Even in that moment when you are feeling condemned, even when your heart condemns you, God is greater than your heart. Why? Because God knows you for who you really are. He knows that you are righteous and holy and blameless. You're just a saint who missed the road. Am I making sense to you? Okay, so God knows who you are. Even when your heart is still condemning you, God knows who you are. He never condemns you. The Holy Spirit never condemns the believer. The Holy Spirit condemns the world. And you are not of the world. The Bible says when the Spirit of God comes, he will convict the world of sin. You are not of the world. You are a saint. You are in Christ. You are in this kingdom. He doesn't convict you of sin. He reminds you of your right standing before God and tells you, child, you are better than what you are doing here. Rise up. Don't stay with the pigs. Don't stay in the doldrums of life. Rise up to your position in Christ and live the life that God has in store for you. That is what you do when you fall into sin. You don't grovel in the dirt and stay there. No, you run back to your Father. You run back to your Father. As a matter of fact, when the Bible says that, come boldly to the throne room of grace so you can receive help in time of need, the illustration in the Aramaic, which was the word spoken when Christ was here, was the word that suggested a ship that was on high sea that has been battered and couldn't move forward. And that ship comes to receive reinforcement. When you find yourself falling, people of God, don't run away from your Father. Run towards him so that you can receive reinforcement that will jack you out of that state. This message is saying to you, sin is not your nature. Sin is not what you do. You are no longer a sinner. You are a saint. You make mistake, run back to your Father. You make mistake, run back to your Father. Don't leave anything hiding under the darkness. You are not of darkness. You are of the light. There is therefore now no condemnation to them who are in Christ Jesus. Praise God forevermore. Beloved child of God, if you have a sin regarding which you find it difficult to accept the Father's full forgiveness, let your mind dwell on the truth of Tetelestai. And then put that sin on God's ledger and write paid in full next to it. The truth inherent in the word Tetelestai should give every believer great assurance, comfort and peace that all of our sin debt, past, present and future, is paid in full. And there remains no sacrifice to be paid. There's nothing we must or even could contribute to the remission of our debt except to receive the free gift of eternal life by faith. Praise God forevermore. All right, this is about where I'm going to stop today. Next week, I will talk about three things that happened at the cross. Three things that happened at the cross. And I believe I have a story to tell. There's a story that I found somewhere that captures, how we should be relating to God. I will talk about that next week. And that will be the end of this series. Praise God. Now, if you want to give your life to Jesus, this Tetelestai message has come and it's hit you hard. You're thinking, I don't even know this Jesus. Maybe you stumbled on this video on YouTube, or a friend shared with you. You have never known Jesus, the one who raised Lazarus from the dead, the one who died for you before you even committed a crime. I want to offer you the message of salvation this morning. If you will say, if you will believe in your heart that the Lord God raised Jesus Christ from the dead, if you believe in your heart that He died as you, and after 3 days God raised Him from the dead, and you confess that with your mouth, the Bible says you are saved. So I will lead you in prayer of salvation if you're ready for it. Praise God. Say with me, dear Father, I come to you in the name of Jesus. Dear Jesus, I come to you. Receive me. I believe you died for me. I believe you were raised from the dead. I believe that you paid the price I ought to pay. I give my life to you. Receive me now. I believe now that you are my Lord and Savior. I confess that with my mouth that Jesus is my Lord and my Savior. Thank you for having me. In Jesus' name. If you say that sincerely from your mouth and you believe that in your heart, God says, now you're saved. You are welcome to the family of my Father. Praise God forevermore. Hallelujah. Now, another set of prayer I want to pray is for those people. You heard this message, you're struggling with it because you've had so much condemnation from whatever it is you've had that from. It doesn't really matter right now. But you are willing to take God for His word. You are willing to step out on that journey of faith. You are willing to say, Lord, I trust you. I don't really know how this is going to work, but I trust you. I want to take up this journey and walk with you by faith, believing that the finished work of Jesus Christ is what it is. Finished, completely, completely, complete, perfectly perfect. I want to pray with you. I want to pray with you. Please close your eyes as I pray with you. You want to leave the arena of performance-based Christianity to what? To faith-walking Christianity. I really want to pray with you. Praise God. Trust me, you are going to experience the grace of God like you've never experienced before. There will be a flood coming your way that you've never experienced before, because joy will start to bubble forth from your spirit. Oh, Father, I thank you for these ones. They have been born again for many years, but Lord, they live under condemnation, under fear that they are not good enough, under fear that they are not accepted, under fear that they might lose their salvation, or that they might miss God. Dear Father, I pray, Lord, as they meditate upon these words, as they take a step of faith to find you themselves. Lord, you were never lost, but to find you, they pant after you, to read through the scriptures and decide to walk by faith, not understanding where they are going. Lord, I thank you because as your word has promised us, you are going to come and sup with them. You are going to come and live with them. You're going to come and embrace them. Lord, you are already embracing them, just that they don't know. I pray, Lord, that the veil is removed from their eyes right now. They might see that it is tetelestai. It is finished. It remains finished. It continues to be finished forever. That the work that Christ completed at Calvary's Hill for us is perfectly perfect, completely complete for all time. Lord, I pray, Lord, that this one will come into relationships. It will come into ministers of the gospel that will teach them about the word in ways that they've not known before. The gospel will be taught to them. That wonderful Holy Spirit will begin to unravel the beauty of Jesus unto them in the name of Jesus Christ. That this one, oh Lord, we have an encounter with the Holy Ghost, an encounter with Jesus that will change their lives. That this one, oh Lord, will be gospel financiers. They will be evangelists. They will be people that will preach the gospel to the ends of the earth. Lord, I thank you that you wake them up. You wake them up and show them the vision, the purpose for their lives in the name of Jesus Christ, that they will run this race, oh Lord, with tenacity and focus in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, oh Lord, for support system. Thank you for helping them. Thank you, Almighty God, that you light up their heart with your fire in the name of Jesus. Lord, we give you praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank you so much for allowing me to pray for you that way. I'm so excited that you've begun a journey, you know, that will change your life. Next week, I'm going to be talking 3 things that happened at the cross. You don't want to miss that, because I'm going to be sharing with you why you should not be afraid of Satan, why you should not be afraid of the law of Moses, and why you should not be afraid of the issue of sin. And why, when he said it is finished, tetelestai, those 3 things got accomplished at the cross. 3 things that happened at the cross. And that will really help you. So please, come next week, invite your friends, and I'll be seeing you. Before you go, please wait our media team. I've got a couple of announcements that I think, please, you really need to hear, and I'll be seeing you soon. God bless you. Remember, you are blessed and highly favored. The Lord is with you. The Lord is for you. The Lord is in you, and all things are working together for your good. Remember, it's our month to accelerate. God bless you, really good. I'll speak to you another time.
Thank you for worshiping with us. We hope you enjoyed the service. We were blessed to have you. We hope to see you again every Wednesday for midweek service at 6 p.m. UK time, every Saturday morning for prayers at 6 a.m. UK time, and Sunday service at 8 a.m. UK time. The replay for today's service will premiere on YouTube at 10 a.m. UK time. For love offering, kindly use the bank details on your screen, or you can scan the QR code on your screen to give via PayPal. Have you heard about grace many times, but have found it difficult to apply what you have heard and learned about it? Come Wednesday, the 4th of May 2022, the Lighthouse is hosting its first ever Practicality of Grace meeting, where all your questions about grace will be answered. With the help of the Holy Spirit, we will share our experiences and difficulties and learn how to apply grace in areas of our lives where we are finding it difficult. This is a safe space for the believer in Christ, and you do not want to miss this.
Hooray! We are excited to announce that the Macy's store is doing its first Easter giveaway. Come Easter Sunday, we are giving away gift cards worth £20 to 5 lucky winners. That is £20 worth of gift card to 5 lucky winners each. Do you think you're one of them? It is simple. Instructions will be posted on our IG page, so follow the page and earn a chance to win a gift card. Also, we will be discounting all products at a 20% discount rate. Yes, you heard that right. 20% discount rate on all of our products, because we love our customers and we want you to share in the joy of Easter. Hurry now, while this promo season is ongoing. We are so excited to see you win.
Lord, you're worthy, from the rising of the sun to the going down of the same.